it's my honor to welcome you to the 24th annual Rose Sheinberg Lecture. I want to say a few words about Rose Sheinberg. There's a few words in the program, but just to underscore, we think we live in difficult times, and we indeed do. But when Rose Sheinberg was a night law student here at NYU in the 1950s, progressives of any sort were labeled as communists by the federal government, by the state government, and were subject to all kinds of serious firings and imprisonment and forced testimony, et cetera, and so forth. State enforced racial segregation was the law of the land in many states. Sexual minorities were completely invisible. Indeed, the sexual majority, that is to say women, were virtually invisible. And she lived a life of resistance in that world. Her family endowed this lecture to honor her. This is the first time in the 24 years of the program that Richard and Jill Sheinberg have not been here, and we're all missing them. Everybody's saying, where's Richard and where's Jill? At least the folks who've been here before. The Sheinbergs sought to create a program that would remain cutting edge and of interest to students. And they structured it, the structure that they conceived is a self-perpetuating group of students. And we select two students from the first year class, and they serve for their entire law school career. And applications are now open for that position. I want to acknowledge the members of the current committee who selected Mary Elena and organized this day. Alina Das of the Immigrants' Rights Clinic is not here. She's been on the committee for a long time. She got tenure last year and is taking a sabbatical, but I suspect that she's working with immigrants, and calling that a sabbatical. Naomi Sunshine, Associate Director of the Lawyering Program, has been with us for 3 years and will need to come back next year as an honored guest because she's moving on to greener pastures. Lawyering Professor Melina Haley has agreed to fill Naomi's huge shoes, and we're very happy about that. Three student members will be graduating, Edie Joseph, right there, and two who I think are not here, Tyler Walton and Caleb Vincent, who's studying at Princeton this semester, so cannot be here. Those three will be leaving a tough act to follow, but the leadership falls to Nora Thurl, Nora right here, and Miriam Marks. So it's a great committee. Also, thanks to the co-sponsoring organizations that are listed in the program. I get to introduce John Wilhelm, who I just met. He was a giant, and is a giant in the labor movement. For many, many years, he led the fastest growing private sector labor organization in the United States. That's a tribute in these times. He created model programs for rank and file membership participation. He created and nurtured diversity within the union that was extraordinary. He led citywide hotel industry negotiations in San Francisco, Boston, Los Angeles, and Las Vegas, many of those places more than once. And he represented the non-faculty workers at the Yale University, which we probably all heard about in the news. So welcome to John, and he'll tell us about Maria Elena. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Sylvia. I can't tell you how delighted I am to be invited to introduce your speaker. I want to tell you a little about her. I've known her for a long time. It is taken for granted that California is politically a blue state. That should not be taken for granted. many people, especially the East, don't know that until the 1990s, California voted for the Republican candidate for president in every single election except 1964. Every other one until the 1990s. Since 1983, Republicans have held the governor's chair in California for 24 years and Democrats for only 10 in that period. And yet today, Democrats hold every statewide office, both US Senate seats, and overwhelming majorities in the congressional delegation and the legislature. And the majority of those Democratic majorities aren't just Democrats. The majority of them really are truly progressive Democrats. Now, California, of course, is not without its problems, in particular, income inequality and runaway housing costs. But the state is the focus of resistance in this country. It's a bulwark for immigrants. It has preserved its social safety net arguably better than any other state. It's a high-tax state that is booming economically. Somebody should tell the Republicans that that works. And I recite that because you're about to hear from the woman who is, more than any other single person, responsible for creating present-day progressive California. Maria Elena Durazo is the seventh of 11 children born to migrant farm workers. Her six older sisters were born in Mexico. She was the first born in the United States in that family. She grew up following the crops with her family, working the fields, often sleeping in barns or tents or trailers, attending lots of different schools. She was pushed by a self-educated father who believed strongly in formal education, and she graduated from St. Mary's College in California, only the second person in her family to attend college. She then attended the People's College of Law. Those of you from other law schools might want to research the People's College of Law in Los Angeles. And she was a single mom working at the same time to support herself and her son. Her first paid activist job was an organizer with the International Ladies Garment Workers Union. And then starting in the mid-1980s, she became involved with Local 11 of HERE, the Hotel Workers Union, as it was known then, which is now known as Unite Here. Maria Elena led a badly needed reform of Local 11 and was elected its president. And she served in that capacity for many years. And then she was elected as the top officer of the Los Angeles County Federation of Labor, which under her leadership became the most successful and most progressive central labor council in the country. Now she's back in Unite Here as its general vice president for immigration, civil rights, and diversity. I could go on for another hour about all the many other important positions she has held, but I'd rather tell you why she's unique. Maria Elena Durazo is a fierce fighter for immigrants and for all workers. Her singular contribution, in my opinion, is her insistence that we demand legal rights for immigrants and simultaneously that we organize them into unions and demand their rights as workers as well as immigrants. And she delivers that insistence with extraordinary eloquence and charisma. Conventional wisdom, and you may have heard this, has it that California changed politically because of backlash to the anti-immigrant Proposition 187, which was sponsored by California Republicans in 1994. That conventional wisdom is dangerously incomplete. Another piece of conventional wisdom in the 1990s was that Latinos and other immigrants mostly couldn't register to vote because they were undocumented, and that even Latinos who were citizens wouldn't register and vote in significant numbers. Maria Elena insisted, on the contrary, that if the labor movement organized immigrants and fought for their rights both at work and in the community, immigrant workers could be mobilized politically. She pointed out in the 1990s that many Latinos and other immigrants were citizens eligible to register and vote. She pointed out with great prescience that there was already then in process a wave of children of immigrants, like herself, born in this country and therefore citizens and eligible to register and vote as they were turning 18. What was in the 1990s a wave of those young citizens has now become a tsunami. Maria Elena was one of the first to debunk the advice of virtually all Democratic political consultants who said that citizens in immigrant communities didn't feel strongly about the immigrant rights issue. Remember that? And so Democrats should confine their appeals to traditional issues of healthcare and education and so forth rather than the more controversial fight for immigrants. Nonsense, said Maria Elena. Many citizens are, like herself, in mixed citizen and non-citizen families, and all of them are in mixed citizen and non-citizen communities. They care deeply and emotionally often about immigrant rights. Her point of view fell on deaf ears among California Democrats in the 1990s. So, characteristically, she just decided to show them. She began with a special election for an open California Assembly seat in 1998. Gil Cedillo was one of the many candidates. He polled at 10% the day before the election. And yet, he confounded everyone by winning. He won because Maria Elena went to the members of Unite Here Local 11 with this message. In our union, she said, we organize and fight to win respect on the job and better wages and benefits. But she said, that's not enough. We also need to organize and fight politically so we can win respect as the good Americans that we are. She sent hotel workers, many of them undocumented, to organize door to door. They organized citizens in their immigrant community to register and vote, even though many of the door knockers could not themselves register and vote. And what the door knockers found was that no one had ever spoken to these immigrant citizens about voting. And their response to somebody actually coming to talk to them was extremely enthusiastic. And Cedillo won. That was the beginning of the political transformation of California. At Local 11 and then at the Los Angeles County Federation of Labor, Maria Elena built a coalition of immigrants, African Americans, and white workers who together transformed California and made it the progressive powerhouse that it is today. I want to read you an excerpt from a New Yorker magazine article about Texas this past August. And I'm reading from the article. Texas leads the nation in Latino population growth. Latinos account for more than half the 2.7 million new Texans since 2010. Every Democrat in Texas believes that if Latinos voted at the same rate in Texas as they do in California, the state would already be blue. The difference between Texas and California is the labor movement, said Garnett Coleman, a Houston member of the Texas House. Labor unions create a culture of voting and political participation, he said. Now Maria Elena is taking the next step in her remarkable career. She's a candidate in the 2018 election for the state Senate from Los Angeles. She'll win that election. We take nothing for granted, but she'll win the election. And she'll bring her unique and uniquely progressive leadership and her insistence on organizing to the California legislature. I know the California legislature, and it has a lot of good things about it, but I promise you, they won't know what hit them when she gets there. I don't use the word hero much, but it's my honor now to introduce you to my friend and comrade, and I think a genuine American progressive hero, Maria Elena Durazo.
Wow. Am I lucky or what? Have someone like John here. Thank you, my dear friend John, for that introduction. And I'm really, really honored that you were here with me today. So I also want to thank everyone here, the New York, the NYU Law School, the Rose Sheinberg Lecture Committee, Sylvia, for being such a wonderful hostess to the Sheinberg family, humbled to be part of this legacy. As John said, I was born and raised in the Central Valley of California. That's a different world from what California looks like on television. The Central Valley is called the Appalachia of the West. I was one of 11 kids, as John said, in the migrant farm worker family. My father came from Mexico during World War II, and he enlisted in the U.S. Army. When he got out, he worked in the fields. So first he, and later each one of us, picked cotton, grapes, green beans, everything else that was grown in that state, and lived in town after town up and down California. And actually, we also traveled and worked in Oregon. And what was going on at that time, and to some degree, hasn't changed nearly enough. My older sisters constantly battled the sexual advances from foremen and labor contractors. These were the days before toilets in the fields, before cleaning water. It was quite humiliating not to have toilets. I remember the crop dusters flying low to spray pesticides on the fields while we were working. We picked your food all day to buy our food the next day. My oldest sisters were good students and they liked school, but they dropped out to help support the family. I always knew there was something unfair, because no matter how hard we worked, from sunup to sundown, we still slept on the back of our flatbed truck. We remained invisible. Today we live in a time when people look at their phones more than they look at one another. Pope Francis has put it profoundly when he says, when the economy loses contact with the faces of the people, it becomes faceless and ruthless. Me, I'm blessed. John Wilhelm believed in me. He inspired me. He empowered me. He was my leader. He did what a real leader should do. He led by example, and I tried my darnest to follow that example. With the support of men like John Wilhelm, women of my generation have broken many glass ceilings. But it's the young women leaders that we in turn nurture who are taking us all to new heights. I feel I have lived a privileged life because every day I get to work with remarkable people, hotel and food service workers. Their jobs of cooking and cleaning and washing dishes may seem quite ordinary, but their stories, their dreams, their willpower are absolutely extraordinary. There are few experiences more powerful than watching an immigrant who walked across the desert to get to the US, walk door to door, talking to neighbors in a political campaign, and then walk into her own polling place to vote. Much that has been written about what we have accomplished in California is deeply offensive. The so-called experts attribute our progress there to demography. It's as though everything that has happened is a result of Mexicans having a lot of babies. Nonsense. 20 years ago, California was the home of the anti-immigrant movement in America. Suddenly, driver's license were denied. Access to public education and health care for immigrants was denied by a vote of the people. And just 9 years ago, marriage equality was voted down. Today, women in the much revered Silicon Valley don't get paid what men are paid. But what we have done and continue to do in California is the nitty-gritty, the hard work of organizing. Organizing workers, organizing neighborhoods, organizing to resist and ultimately be ready to disobey Donald Trump. Cesar Chavez is much remembered for his widely used and copied slogan, "Si se puede," yes you can. But those of us who worked with him or were trained by his union's movement, we remember another slogan, one that's never been in the news. Cesar taught that organizing is about, quote unquote, one. One person at a time, one person listened to, one person respected. Cesar would say, one by one by one. We changed the electorate. We made millions into citizens and millions more into voters. And we walked and talked and worked until we wanted to cry. And we made it happen the only way us Mexicans know how. We outworked our enemies. We outsmarted them. And we did what I think we need to do again. Governor Pete Wilson ran an anti-immigrant TV ads in 1994. And we called those ads racist. And the Republicans have never recovered. Some of our opponents have learned over the last 20 years that you don't try to insult and intimidate the bravest people in this country. The refugee from violence and deprivation who jumped onto a freight train, who was confronted by thieves, who carried his child, who went without food, who walked through the nights, who didn't know a soul, who couldn't speak the language, who started as a day laborer and then washed cars and then dishes and then joined our union and became a leader where he worked, an activist where he lived, and a citizen whose vote changed California. Few people understand that man or woman I just described isn't someone's story, it's millions of stories. We recognize that labor's future was tied to the fate of the growing immigrant community and the Latino community, both native-born and immigrant. And when you join that group with African-American sisters and brothers, with union members, and with progressives, that was the future, and that was power. The Los Angeles labor movement led the national American labor movement in standing up for immigrant worker rights and forged the alliance that led to the California we know today. That was and is the basis of our California story. And it's how my union turned Nevada from deep, dark red into a state that rejected Donald Trump and elected the first Latina to the United States Senate. One voter, one union member, one immigrant at a time. A few years ago, we decided to bring the California story to Arizona. Hotel housekeepers and airport food service workers, immigrants from Mexico and North Africa, working together, working hard, working long hours, was started to change politics there. When we asked them how they wanted to get started to build that power, they said, "Show us how to get rid of Sheriff Joe Arpaio." We did. We taught them. We empowered them. We called our campaign Adios Arpaio. Hundreds of young high school students who had seen their moms and dads subjected to Arpaio's racist profiling joined our union members. We lost in 2012, but we told everyone how we had lost in California before we won. We kept going, they kept going, and 4 years later, we celebrated Adios Arpaio. My union, Unite Here, is going to do in Arizona what we did in Nevada and what we did before that in California. Now, I'm a bit older than some of you, and I'm sure you don't want me to sound like your mother. I know we live in a time that honors all that's new, newer, newest, but I believe deeply and profoundly in two very old-fashioned words: collective bargaining. Collective, an old-fashioned word that means community, a collective, people who combine their talents, their collective worth, their collective power, power that they know is greater than their individual influence. One man or woman walking across a bridge in Selma, Alabama, means very little. But a collective of people crossing that same bridge changes the world. Bargaining is another old-fashioned word used for a transaction. You give me a dollar, I give you a hot dog, bam, there's the deal. But the one thing we all know about bargaining is that it can only happen between equals. In a job, a worker cannot be equal to the person who can fire them. That's why a worker needs to be part of a collective. Unions are for things we can't do alone, because collective action makes people equal, and equality is what changes things. It's what makes the world a better place. Equality is the all-American value. It trumps injustice, trumps ideology, trumps the new economy. It trumps Trump. Collective bargaining may be two old words, but they mean real equality at work, enforceable equality at work. Strength only comes through equality, and equality only comes when workers have rights that they themselves can enforce. That's why workers are willing to go to great lengths, take enormous risks. They know the value of being able to sit across the table from their employer and negotiate about their working and, frankly, their living conditions. Men and women know their worth and their contributions, but without collective bargaining, without equality, they are powerless. I was with a group of hotel workers just 2 days ago, and they are talking to their coworkers about having a union. Their fears are real. Fears of getting harassed and targeted and fired and even deported, separated from their families. But their needs are real too. Their children, their bodies that hurt, just putting food on the table. Some of us work hard to change the laws to help workers. But frankly, legislated equality has its limits. Why are people still working to end wage theft? In my city of Los Angeles, the estimate is that $26 million is stolen from workers every week. Just think about that. $26 million a week in stolen wages. Why have 26 farm workers died in California after being denied water and shade? Why didn't universal health care cover everybody? The Affordable Care Act specifically prohibits coverage for undocumented immigrants. It even prohibits those immigrant workers from using their own money to buy health insurance through the exchanges. And here's the uncomfortable truth. Winning through legislation is a step and should not be the goal. Not a single farm worker who has a United Farm Workers Union contract has died of heat, because those workers have equality. Their agreement gives them the right to stand up for themselves and not wait for a government inspector who will never show up. Not a single hotel worker who has a Unite Here contract has been a victim of wage theft, because those workers have equality. Their collective bargaining agreement gives them the right to get their money and not have to wait for a court or a prosecutor or anyone else. Not a single undocumented immigrant worker who has a good union contract is denied health insurance, because those workers have equality. And this truth brings me to a point. We must guard against strategies that make workers more dependent on the government and politicians. In every living wage, minimum wage fight I have led, I have always protected that equality, real equality, because no matter what wage we legislate, only a collective bargaining agreement stops wage theft. Uber drivers will remain today's sharecroppers until they win the right to organize. It's so ironic to listen to business interests raise hell about collective bargaining. These guys, and yes, they are guys, these guys don't do a damn thing with each other without a contract, because they know they can't trust each other. And we know we can't trust them either. In the Silicon Valley of Northern California, the janitors, the cafeteria workers, the security officers, bus drivers, people of all different colors, from all different places, with a determination and aspiration, are fighting and learning to collectively bargain. Take Nahima, a cafeteria worker. She was living with her three kids in one bedroom of someone else's home because that was all they could afford. They didn't have the space to put up a Christmas tree. So she moved out to the Central Valley. Rent was cheaper. She got the space to put a Christmas tree for her kids. Her commute is now 4 hours a day. She doesn't see her kids very much. So she's fighting for the right to collectively bargain. I want to share a thought that is through talking to other people, especially now on this campaign for office. You know, in the late 1960s, when Ronald Reagan was governor of California, he pulled off something that he never took credit for and was never understood to be a profound change. He placed a California constitutional amendment on the ballot, and then he pushed for its passage. It was a constitutional right to privacy. At that time, no one suspected his motivation, but it became the beginning of the gay rights movement. The legal underpinning to repeal the sodomy laws in California, repeals he signed a few years later. Few people are aware of what that constitutional amendment did for the reproductive freedoms that his wife Nancy Reagan quietly believed in. I'm the farthest thing from a Reagan Democrat. But I think we ought to pursue something like he did in California. I believe it's time to push for a constitutional right to literacy. You all are blessed. You are here. You are educated. But millions of children in America are never going to get here. Going to have what you have. And no speech is going to change that. Kids who can't read can't succeed. They have no shot, no future, no nothing. If the government is going to fail children, deny them the right to literacy, then I think those children ought to have the right to sue the government. Sue them all. Get some meaningful action going. Think about it. And maybe you can offer me your minds and help me to take this idea further and pursue it. Sisters and brothers, we are living in an era of hate and hostility, and worse yet, of bad policy. It's wrong that dreamers are threatened with deportation when all they have done wrong is go to school and go to work. It's wrong that veterans of the United States military are being deported. It's wrong that workers who complain about wage theft are subjected to ICE raids when they seek justice in the state labor commissioner's offices. It's wrong to take away the temporary protected status to almost 500,000 Haitians, Central Americans, and other workers with TPS. If we accept the hard work of immigrants, if we eat the food they harvest, the meals they cook, and eat off the dishes they wash, if we sleep in the hotel rooms they clean, walk on the cement they pour, drive the cars they wash, recycle the cans and bottles they sort, then we must accept them as our own, as our sisters and brothers. I am so proud of my union that's been in the leadership of efforts to make immigration laws and policies more humane and smarter. But it's time for a new level of stepping up. Employers and churches and more unions and good people all over this nation must stand up in a stronger way for immigrants in this country. Not once, not one rally, but seriously, stand up to this administration. We have to stand up to all those unconstitutional orders that keep pouring out of this administration. And we must be prepared to disobey those orders. Every one of us, all of us in each of these sectors, have got to be prepared to disobey Donald Trump. When we disobey those orders, we show our love for America. When we march, when we sit in, when we sit down or strike, we honor heroes like Dr. King and Dolores Huerta and Cesar Chavez. When we march, when we sit in, when we sit down or strike, we honor Lucy Parsons, who led the demand for an 8-hour day. We have to lock arms and build a wall around our families to protect our nation's children. We must defend Muslims and lesbians, Mexicans and queers, white America and black America, women and men. We have to reawaken America's better soul. And then and only then will we be a true leader in the world. Sisters and brothers, let me sum up what my entire life has been about. As we strive to do good in the world, we can never forget the most good comes for the most people when we empower them to do good for themselves. Thank you very much, and thank you for having me here.
Well, thank you so much for being here. I know one of the things that we've talked about in terms of what hope there is for Congress on these issues is whether there really is a way to come up with any sort of legislation on some of the issues you've mentioned, whether it's workers' rights, immigrant rights, that doesn't make a whole segment of our population a bargaining chip for more enforcement, for more raids, more of the things you've talked about. So I'm curious, based on all of the work you've done on the ground to really bring people to a consensus, if you think that's even possible in Congress, given who we have in office today?
Yes. Wait, you have to answer with the mic, because we're recording this.
Yes, I do believe. I'm not sure about a complete, comprehensive package that we all believe in, but I do believe so. You know, our union and a couple of other unions have been over the last 15, 20 years negotiating into our collective bargaining agreements language to, as much as we can, protect immigrant workers. We are finding that at this moment, it's no longer much of a demand to employers, you know, many employers, many more than 20 years ago, to try to protect their workforce. They are much more willing to cooperate and work together. In fact, in some employers have asked us to do joint training with the managers and the workers around the issues of immigration, such as the issue of letting ICE in or not in unless they have a judicial warrant, not just an ICE warrant, but a judicial warrant. So we're finding more openness, and you could see sort of because the tech companies, you know, sort of took the lead in getting those companies to stand up and take a position, for example, in support of DACA. There are many, many employers. I just saw a list of probably 80 associations of businesses, from construction contractors to all sorts of businesses, including from our industry, hospitality industry, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce just signed a statement last week in support of TPS. So they're in support, many of them in support of DACA. They know what that means to their workforce. Many are in support of TPS. Our union did a great job a few months ago when we first got word that Haitian TPS could be, you know, withdrawn. And this had never happened before, but Disney took a position in support of Haitian TPS. The Greater Miami Hotel Association, the National Hotel and Motel Association, took a step in support of Haitian TPS. I'm convinced, maybe it's still wishful thinking, maybe it's a dream, but I'm convinced that the only reason we got a 6-month, it's not a full reprieve, but a 6-month extension for the Haitian TPS was because those employers stood up. Now, you know, they don't have to go out and march and picket, but they stood up and took a position that this is important. And frankly, what are they gonna do if 50,000 Haitians become undocumented? What are they gonna do? So it becomes a practical issue on the one hand of, imagine 800,000 DACA recipients become undocumented, I mean overnight, even if it's a year or 6 months. That means there's like an average of 1,500 people who could lose their jobs every week just because of their status. How are you gonna replace them? So I think there's some practical, now, will they have the courage to stand up? You know, we'll see. And really use their political clout? We'll see. But if that were to happen, I think we have a shot. I realize it's still a big if. But that's what I mean about all of us pushing in that direction. We can't just stay silent at this particular time. And if everybody took responsibility to be much more proactive, I think we have a shot, at least for now, for that, between those two groups, that's something like 1.2 million people who we could stop from becoming undocumented. So I have to have faith, and that's one of the ways I think that we could have an impact. Universities all over the country are taking position with in support of DACA. That's helpful. Again, I think it's a question, will they use their real political clout with the Trump administration, or are they just gonna go along?
Another question?
If somebody has a different opinion or another idea, I would love to hear it, so please don't hold back.
So you've spoken about many successful and inspiring organizing campaigns. And these are happening in the face of more and more hostility to labor from the courts. And from my perspective, weaker and weaker enforcement of the labor laws that we have, at least for the worker side. So I'm curious if you have any thoughts about what, if anything, can be done about that from the local level or the state level?
You mean as far as strengthening? Well, I think, for example, we learned this, you know, with John and my other comrade, Henry. We had to develop a whole different set of tools. And I was talking about that earlier today. A whole different set of tools to help workers so they're not left out there alone trying to battle these companies. And as our industry changed from the general manager at one hotel making a decision about collective bargaining, you know, became national and then international, and pretty soon is like, in many cases, Hilton, the name Hilton doesn't have anything to do with it because private equity owns this hotel and they call the shots, right? So as that developed, we had to come up with a whole different set of ways in which we could help those workers. Some of it is developing more international, a stronger international solidarity work. It's also developing stronger allies and relationships. You know, usually it was the union would battle on its own. But when you spread that and you make it something that it's a whole community saying to the company, this is wrong, you've got to do something about it, and then develops things like boycotts and the use of boycotts. We've developed a thing called the a program called the Fair Hotel, which promotes good hotels and then puts the light on bad, you know, employers. So there's a whole bunch of things to help persuade employers that they're better off and respecting the right to collectively bargain and not, you know, have this big fight that's going to go on. We've also shown that we're prepared to go on as long as it takes. And, you know, we have examples like in Las Vegas. How long was that? Yeah. John led this with the leaders of Las Vegas at the Horseshoe.
Frontier.
I got them. That was another strike at the Frontier. But it wasn't only the workers on strike for all those years. It was the whole labor movement and a lot of other things that came through. So I think that has to be put out there much more in our organizing. And then we turn around and we can strengthen the laws. So we strengthen the laws in California for what defines an independent contractor. That in turn would help workers, you know, fall into the employee status. So I think there's lots of ways in which we could, we are making the laws stronger in response to being another tool for those workers.
Yes.
Oh, and then, go ahead.
Sorry, just to clarify, when you say strengthen the law, do you mean working with legislatures or with strategic litigation, or what do you mean exactly?
Yes, with laws. I mean, I think that there's a lot of other ways, policies that can be done either at the local or county or at the state level, but at all those levels we can do that. We passed minimum wage laws at the local level, you know, that hadn't been done in decades. We passed worker retention laws so that workers in a certain place, and what triggered this law was companies doing business at the LAX airport, where, you know, the airport let go of one big company, and then they brought in a bunch of non-union food service operations. This was at LAX years ago. So we got a law passed that said, if the companies change, the workers stay. And so it's a worker retention law, and that's to give some stability both to the airport as well as to the workers themselves. So why should they? I mean, you know, preparing food doesn't matter who it is that's running the operation. So I think there are lots of ways that gives us stability, so then the incoming employer can't, you know, fire all those workers, and those workers have a better chance of retaining the union if they do that. So I think those are examples of the laws and policies that we changed.
Hi, thank you for being here. I am the daughter of an immigrant and an immigration attorney, so your words hit close to home. I worked with migrant farm workers this past summer conducting outreach to H-2A workers. And I was wondering what your thoughts are on how you envision collective mobilization within a government schema that doesn't seem to actually support these workers and their rights. So far, I was working in Illinois, and so far it doesn't seem like there's much unionizing among workers. So do you have any thoughts?
Amongst the farm workers?
Amongst the farm workers, yeah.
Well, I think California is still the only state that provides a legal right to be union. The only state in the country. So that's even further behind. It's not even enforcing their labor rights. They don't have the right to be, you know, in a union. I think that this, what I could see this administration going towards, and it's said very openly, is that they are for temporary guest workers. That's why they want to cut, with the RAISE Act, they want to cut legal migration into the country by half. They don't want anything that looks like, smells like you could stay here longer. But only, I mean, look, Trump himself has all these guest workers at his Mar-a-Lago, you know, resort. So they want pure temporary status, pure guest worker status. They know they're going to have to fulfill work needs. There's no doubt about it. But they don't want to do it in any way which is going to provide equal rights for those workers, for them as workers, and they can just find, like the Bracero program of years past, except extend it. They've increased the number of temporary visas, guest worker visas. They want to slash the legal migration in half. So that's the direction. That's what Jeff Sessions has said very openly. That's where we should be going, and he's not going to support anything that in any way gives rights. So again, you know, the number of people who have no rights will be increased, and that's what they're looking for, which again comes back to, there may be some businesses or employers who say, oh, that's great, I like that idea. But in the end, I think that we have to convince more employers and more businesses that's not a good idea, and that they need to stand on the side of defending, with us, on the side of defending workers. Yes.
We have to move the mic.
No.
Because we're recording.
Is this being recorded?
It's being recorded. Yeah. We can all.
Hi. You're about to have, or we now have a Republican LRB for the first time in a few years, and we're going to have a Republican general counsel in a month or two. How are you going to work around that?
I'm trying to think of how to say this publicly. I mean, it's going to be, as far as the laws and the decisions are concerned, there's no doubt it's going to be a very big step backwards. And it's gonna hurt us for several years. I mean, we had barely started to see the benefits of a Obama administration, barely. In the last few years, with some of those decisions that were, okay, you can actually have an election and, you know, it won't take years and years. So, and we had just started to utilize that as a way, and workers, you know, actually being able to have an election. it was under that rule that the Trump casino workers in Las Vegas eventually won recognition and a contract. On the other hand, you know, there have been many times in this country where we didn't have the laws on our side. We didn't have any laws, period. And that didn't stop labor from organizing workers. And we do that still to a great degree. We never, we changed from relying on elections because they meant nothing, and immediately just started working for contract neutralities as a way of really respecting a worker's right to organize. So I say we move around it. Nothing says we have to go to the National Labor Relations Board, and if it's going to be a bad thing for the workers, let's just go straight to it. Let's just duke it out. Mm-hmm. Duke it out, and as if there was no law. So that's probably more than I should say, but I do think that there is a lot of tools that we could be much more creative about, and that's what we're trying to do. We are not going to let this administration stop us from organizing. And I think that more unions need to look at it that way. We cannot depend on government decisions or who's in office to decide whether or not we organize. And that's partially the reason why the density of unionization fell in this country, is because it was getting so difficult. And it was true, employers were, you know, using the law to delay decisions for years and years and years. So it, on the one hand, that was true. But we can't allow that to stop us because workers want this. Recently, I don't know the exact number, but the percentage of Americans who support unionization has shot up 15, 20%. So we know men and women out there want a union. It's up to us to live up to that and do everything we can.
Hi, thank you so much for being here. My question is about, so I think in this moment, a lot of people are bemoaning the difficulty of reaching voters on the other side, reaching the middle, reaching folks who disagree with us. And it seems like in California, you've had a model of success in being able particularly to move more old line unions, construction unions, unions that were not immigrant friendly in many aspects, to be on the same page with you, both with respect to immigration rights as well as other progressive policies. And so I'm wondering if you could talk more about that process and what you've learned about moving people who disagree with you that we might all benefit from.
Well, success has a way of getting support. And when you're successful, people look around and say, well, I may not like that, you know, she's reaching out to immigrants if I don't like immigrants. But if that's the way we elected a more progressive, labor-friendly person to office, then you've got their attention. And so we started electing by creating that coalition of voters. We started electing people who were more union-friendly. And you know what? That led to more PLAs, and that led to other things that were not being won, hadn't been won for a really long time. So if that's the formula that worked, then that's the formula that convinced, you know, those who wouldn't on their own do that. We passed in LA what's called a construction careers policy. And that policy allowed for a number of things. It allowed for more local hire and more local hire from communities that hadn't been hired to work in the construction industry. But we did that because we were able to also demand project labor agreements and unionized construction work at a much higher level. So, you know, if we want to succeed in one way, and it's working in another way that you had. Now, frankly, I had some real battles. I had some real battles with those particular union leaders. Some of them said, stay out of here. It's none of your business. The others said, are you kidding? We're winning. We're winning more project labor agreements. Why do we want? So it stirred it up in such a way that, look, even your own union's interest is better served. And so at the beginning, I must say, you know, and John was there, you know, at the very beginning, is there weren't very many unions who were supportive of this model that has now worked. And there were a bunch of organizations, and the Democrats, I mean, there were a lot who were saying, don't do it, or it's not going to work, or we're not supportive. So like any model, you just have to go do it. And if it works and you're successful, then others will come around to it. If it doesn't, that's okay, we'll try something else. Well, there's gotta be those willing to take the risk, to, you know, put the resources into it, you know. And that's important, putting resources. We didn't, the model in LA and in Nevada and in Arizona was to invest in the rank and file of the union. Now, prior to that, we were known as the ATM of the politicians. just write your checks and hand it over, write your checks and hand it over. But what we started doing was having our own rank and file members with community members be the ones to knock on the doors. And so that was very controversial. The candidates and the electeds, the politicians used to say, you have to give me a check. Well, no, we don't. You know what? We're going to elect the right person, and that's where our resources are going to go. We're not handing you checks anymore. So all of this stirs things up. And it stirs things up with the politicians. It stirs things up within the labor movement. It stirs things up, you know, in our communities. But I'll be damned, what are our choices? If things were getting worse, what could possibly, what could you say? So.
You. Somebody else will go.
You just started talking about the need for an ATM card. obviously, America. American politics are ruled by a lot of donations and big donors. Obviously, your narrative is one that would appeal to the unions backing you. How do you make that same narrative attractive to the big donors at DNC so that they back you? Obviously, you have a relationship with them, but also as you run for a seat for the first time, are you seeing backlash from donors with this narrative?
You know, these models, they worked for big business. They work for small business. They work for the non-traditional, or what people think are the non-traditional allies. And that's because we succeeded in doing things that's benefited several interests. So far, I'm not saying it won't be a backlash. I'm not saying that. But we were able to get I gave an example earlier. Well, this is another example. In Long Beach, where we passed a hotel living wage law, there were something like 700 or 600 small businesses that signed the petition to increase the minimum wage. Okay? So we won allies. We created a new set of allies on the side of workers because it made sense. Those workers, when they got an increase, they're going to spend it. They're going to spend it at the local grocery store. They're going to spend it at the cleaners. They're going to go out and eat with their, it circulates more money. They understood that more than anybody. But, you know, how often do we think like that? We think, oh, no, business, they're not going to want this, right? We won over, when you act like an adult in the room, you could really win over. You could win over a lot of interests, you know. I remember doing a big development downtown. I didn't do it, but there was a huge development that broke through the downtown environment. It used to be in Los Angeles. It was awful. It was dead. It was like no business. It was really terrible. And so with this development, it was going to grow to include some other new things. But we sat down. It was both big developer, AEG, and the environmentalists. And we all sat down in labor and came up with a proposal that was eventually passed at the state level, which modified the timing of our environmental laws, our CEQA laws, right? So that it wouldn't go on for 10 years, but it didn't erase it. It just modified it a slightly bit. Well, that was fair. And the environmentalists are right there with us, developing that language. We've got community support. They never would have done that. That developer would never, ever have been able to do it without labor. And because of the coalition that we believed in. So I think it's just taking a fresh look at the way things are done brings a lot of different interests to the table that wouldn't otherwise. If you shove them aside, then we get nowhere.
Well, it's worth pointing out that that valley you're talking about, as you know, was owned by a right-wing oil billionaire. But he made the deal anyway.
That's right. That's right. So AEG is owned by Anschutz. Anybody ever hear of Phil Anschutz? Yeah. And so that developer, that company, came to be like really, really good relationship, a great relationship. And then from then on, always spoke about how important labor was and, you know, future projects and this sort of thing. So I think we've got to just make better connections. You know, I have a another mentor of mine is Reverend James Lawson out of the civil rights direct action movement. And he's the one who, would always in his workshops and trainings, you got to connect the dots. You got to connect people to each other. And when we do that, we get more done. And I just want to get things done. You know, that's the thing to keep in mind.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much.